Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure for me to be here again and to give this talk for in the SAEC seminar, because we have some collaboration since a few years with QTOF. And I think I will show you some more applications in a research laboratory with different projects that we are working with. So basically, it's QTOF. I will talk about different types of, well, couple of systems. Well, basically, we show you three applications. First one with the last one that the QTOF 500 are with the SWOT acquisition system that we got from SAEC now for 2 or 3 years, already developing applications and in this particular field especially. And then two more applications with the triple TOF that we do a collaboration with Valencia University. Basically, this research, I will focus the research because this is a research which is oriented to a very hot topic, which is contaminants and water reuse. What is the world problem? We have a big problem in the world, as you know, or probably you don't know, or you think that it's solved, but it's not solved, it will not be solved. In fact, the population is growing. Every year is around 80 million people more in the world. And these people need treatment, water treatment. The treatment is advancing in US, in Europe, okay, no problem, but in other parts of the world, there is a problem. So basically, the population growth will go, the people without treatment will go from 1.5 billion to 2.5 billion in 2050. So 2.5 billion is much more than China. So 2.5 billion people still will lack water treatment due to the problems in the world, you know, especially in the developing world, India, Africa, that there is not enough water treatment. What is the tendency now in Europe, but also in some parts of America, with the global change on California? They know it already, lack of water, water scarcity, Australia, is water reuse. More and more water reuse is being implemented. In Europe, we have now a guidelines and even a directive will be launched. And countries are now more and more developing water reuse techniques, water reuse and for agriculture. At this moment, there are two main applications, is agriculture and also groundwater infiltration. But there is a third one, which is now we are working also with this, is for drinking water. Okay, this is not yet implemented in Europe, but it will be implemented. But at this moment, the main worries, main problem, or the main issue is agriculture, and this is the examples that I will give you here. Some countries in south of Europe, well, small countries, Cyprus, Greece, and Malta, they have a lot of wastewater treatment reuse. Spain, Italy, around more than this, because this is an old slide, is around 15%, but it will increase. It will increase because we need to do more and more, you know. When there is a lack of water, either you have two solutions. When you are by the sea, you can have desalination plants. If you are not by the sea, the only solution is to have more treatment. Huh? Okay, with this treatment, of course, what happens? There are two types of things that you need to eliminate. Microbiological, which I think is the main, most important one. I am chemist, and here probably most of you are chemists, but the real problem there and for the authorities is the health, the microbiological, but the chemistry is also very important. So for this, the instrument, the QTOF, is one especially good device, because what we want to investigate is new chemicals. We want to know what is going on there, what kind of chemicals do we have, regulated and unregulated chemicals. So you know that from this point of view, we have different types of methods to analyze wastewater. We have target, which was common, triple quads, suspect screening and unknown identification. More and more in the last years, because of the QTOF technology, is allowing good quantitation and good trace level determination. QTOF instruments are used for this. So basically for this type of work, to look for new chemicals, I think QTOF is an ideal system. Of course, what I will show you here mainly is suspect screening, because what we want to see is we know some of the chemicals and we want to know how the metabolites are being formed. So this is suspect screening. It's not real unknowns. It's not unknown unknowns, okay? So, well, the SAEC, you know, we are familiar with the instrument, the QTOF, you know it already, so I don't, this is the SAEC people, so most of you know the instruments. Basically, it was also mentioned before in the main plenary lecture, that SWOT, respect to IDA, has been an improvement because here now you do fragments from all the signals. You have all the fragments. You can get all the information. In ADA, was only the main fragments that you could get structural information. Now with the SWAT, there is a big improvement because you get much more. You don't need to reinject the sample. So from the software point of view, is really an improvement. I think some of my colleagues said in the years to come, probably the instrumentation companies, they will not only need to work a lot with the instrument itself, but also developing software, because this will make a difference in the application side. Okay, yeah. So this is the settings of the SWAT. So I don't go to the details because it's applying, and you know much better than myself. And what is also good is the library. I think the library is very important when you do this type of work, because you are searching for much more compounds as possible. And I think at this moment they are using a library of 17,000 or 14,000, probably is more already, because this is a slide that we got some time ago. So I think a spectral library is very important to do the matching and to do the identification. I always say to my colleagues and coworkers and everybody that, okay, you can identify by library, fine. But this is not the final match. We are in a mass spectrometry conference. We are mass spectrometers. Final match is a real standard, okay? If you don't have it, don't have it. But then you cannot say 100%. It's close to 100, but it's not 100. Okay, that's to make things clear, because sometimes the young people think that they really identify everything. It's, okay, you identify it, but it's not an equivocal identification. It's close to identification. And then the Q-TOF-TOF, the triple TOF, also that, which is an instrument which is for a few years in Valencia. I think now there is a new device. I show it. Will be presented here in this conference. I will go now for the three applications. We had applications in the laboratory, so what we do is exposure experiments with plants, soil, irrigated with water, contaminated, and we look at the plant uptake of the different chemicals. That's one thing. And the other thing are real samples. Real samples, you will see it here, is my last application. We do work a lot in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, maybe many of you don't know it, it's a very difficult to work there, because you need permissions, you need to have people there. But Saudi Arabia is a country with very wealthy, you know, as you know. They have oil. They don't have water, but they can get water from the sea. They are irrigating. There is no rivers. And all the water that they use for agriculture is wastewater. The Riyadh wastewater is they use it for irrigation. So in this way, similar to Israel. I have been in Israel several times, in Saudi Arabia too. But it's a country that is very difficult to get samples, and here you will see some quite a lot of samples that we do, because we have a running program with them. So first I start with the experiments. This is European Union projects doing different setups of plants. Basically, we will also use two types of crops, let's say food crops like lettuce, mainly lettuce, carrots, things like that. And then you will also see a study in the case of Saudi Arabia, wild plants. I think it's also important to consider that for when you do this type of work, that you have environmental problems, or that could be plants, biodiversity, what happens with the plant, and is really affecting our environment or not. And then the human health problem, okay? If you eat too much food, I mean, one paper from Israel mentions that if you eat too much carrots, because carrots could take much more, for instance, carbamazepin, for instance, for kids could be a problem. No? You know, this is another type of problem, but there are two problems at this time. So the exposition was done with different lettuce in our lab, with light, with soil, with different plants. And we selected a list of chemicals that are really detected in our wastewaters and agreed among the European Union countries, like carbamazepine is well known to be also uptaken. Other ones, ibuprofen, which is used worldwide. Also some illicit drugs like cocaine. And these are the plants, the different plots. Usually you irrigate at high concentration, microgram per liter level. And then you just let the crops grow, the lettuce. And then you look at the lettuce leaves, roots, and soil. You can see different colors. These are exposure plants, so you can see how the chemicals, also the metabolites, valsartan acid, some of the metabolites you can detect, carbamazepine metabolites. So you can see how they metabolize in the plant and what is going on with this. And then you can go to the MS and identify, this is a particular identification by light. library with jasmine methyl ester, ergonine methyl ester in lettuce leaves. So I think it's important to know that some of them, they can go to the leaves, and because people is usually eating the leaves, what is going on after that, this we stop here because the assessment, what happens with human health is another thing. And this is already some environmental real samples from this type of work is now going on the real samples. That's in Spain and other samples in Europe, in France, also in Germany, that we look at this type of work, that looking at the different isolation and where the chemicals go into the soil, leaves, or roots. Sorry. Second example was already done with the triple TOF. This is an example of already done in Saudi Arabia. The two other examples are in Saudi Arabia, because Saudi Arabia is a problem, is a country that only all agriculture is with wastewater reuse. Okay, make things clear. All the crops are with this because there is no other water. It's only wastewater, treated wastewater. So we took an example that was an example of one of the. This is a. Coptea plant is a natural plant from Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, there is a lot of biodiversity, although you may think it's desert. There are some oases, some water areas, and there are many different types of plants, which are is very rich in plants. And they wanted to know what's going on, for instance, when these plants are irrigated with ibuprofen. So we look at this. The experiment was done by them, by themselves, in the plant physiology department at the Riyadh University. It was with high concentration, different plots. It was very well planned experiment by the people there. If you are interested, this work is already published in ABC, in Analytical Bioanalytical Chemistry. Most of the work that I'm presenting here has been already published, except some parts from the beginning. So if you are interested, some of this I can send it to you. These are the, well, we wanted to know what, this is only one chemical that was exposed, ibuprofen. Ibuprofen is most one of the chemicals, pharmaceuticals, much more used worldwide. So you can find in all the samples everywhere. So here we can see how roots, seeds, the different metabolites that you can see, the different distribution of metabolites of ibuprofen, hydroxymetabolites, things like that. So the green colors is much more identification. So you can see here some of this. And here are the roots of conjugation, conjugation with sulfate, glucosides, methylation. So that's quite, this is phase two metabolites. We look at different types of phase metabolites because you can have in plants different types of metabolites. Conjugation with sulfate, glutathione, is a lot of information. I don't want to go into the detail because this is, as I mentioned to you, there is a paper where we had all this list. Some of them were identified with standards, as I mentioned to you. Other ones was library only or mass spectrometer identification. So here is some of the structures. That could be there, and this is the library, for instance, in that case, 400 milligrams. It was a very concentrated solution, 400 milligrams per liter exposure, and here exocyte, so ibuprofen exocyte was identified. And this is the distribution between roots, ibuprofen, different metabolites, oxidized metabolites, ibuprofen, conjugated metabolites in roots, seeds, shoots. So you can have a distribution according to different parts of the plant and the soil. And I think that's, for plant physiologists, is very important information in order to know what is happening after this, if this is really this exposure, because it's a continuous exposure to these chemicals, what is happening after with the plant. I'm not a plant physiologist, but of course there are other people who can do the interpretation. The last example corresponds to the real samples. This is a running program that we are, these are samples correspond to 2018. We also collected 2018. We do a program in all the country on these samples. And well, this is how they irrigate. You may think there's a big treatment plant in Riyadh, but the rest, all this water is coming, is water from the treatment plant. And in fact, they call it Riyadh River. The Riyadh River is the wastewater from Riyadh. Okay? And these are the greenhouses, many greenhouses along the country. So basically, they use pharmaceuticals and pesticides. These are some bottles. And working people usually in Saudi Arabia, most of the people working in the field sites are not Saudi Arabians, usually are related countries or Muslim countries like Egyptians, Pakistan, India, things like that. So then the river, we also took some, because I will show you some example, we also took now microplastics. You know, microplastics is a hot topic. And we also took some water for looking at microplastics. This is the water, but all this water is wastewater, okay? Just to give you an example, these are, and we had, as I mentioned to you, wild plants. There are many wild plants in Saudi Arabia. So, but this, all these samples are real. It's no spiking experiments. So these are the different areas that we look. As I mentioned to you, this is quite interesting new work because there is not much information in this country. If you want to go there, you know, you need visa, you need a lot of permission to do some, any type of work. But people is very kind in order to, they give you all the facilities. When you are there, there is not a problem at all to go to the field sites and to. So the chemicals that they are looking at similar to our chemicals, so pesticides and pharmaceuticals, different, a long list of chemicals. Part of this work is already published. Part of this work will be published this year. And here you have, for instance, the different types of chemicals, acetomeprip, carbamazepine, things like that. So you can have contaminants according to the number of occurrence. Some of them, the pharmaceuticals are the blue color. Pesticides are also, they use a lot of pesticides because, you know, temperatures are reaching around 40 degrees. Usually these samples that we collect, usually we do the collection in February, March, because now at this time it's too hot. You will not see almost any plant at all because it's very hot and it's very difficult to work in the field, you know. Here you have some examples on the distribution of pesticides, different pesticides, diacinone, they use many different types of crops, pesticides because, you know, there is a lot of, with the temperature you get a lot of things to take care. So another area to do the sampling, here you have again acidic pharmaceuticals, atenolol, caffeine as well, so all this found. This is in the water samples, sorry, minimum and maximum. You can see pretty high concentrations, although this is far from Riyadh, this is far from the city. You can have even microgram per liter level at certain points from 800, several hundred nanograms up to microgram, maximum concentrations. And this is in the wild flora. Wild flora, they also pick up some of these chemicals. So, and this is pretty interesting because, you know, wild flora needs to be protected. And they are irrigated. So as soon as you irrigate with this water, they also get some of these chemicals. I think this is useful information, especially for the physiologist, to know that this at certain point, because this is every day, of course, and all the time. So what will happen in the future, we don't know, but probably some changes will. In addition to that, as I just a couple of slides, we also look at some microplastics. We are looking more and more this year. So we took different sampling device. This case was at 300 microns. This year we went to a lower size, and we found with microscopy investigation, but you can do, of course, mass spectrometry as well, you know, pyrology, GCMS, and other techniques. There were not many because the size, the particle size, or the mesh size that we used was pretty high, but now this year we were using a bit lower. So the microplastic thing is another business. Maybe some of you are working with this, but there is no standardization and needs much more work to be done. During the conference, there will be a session on Tuesday. We talk about a little bit about this, about the microplastic. So just to end with this, to give you some ideas, the SAEX 500 system is a very useful instrument for screening and for analysis of all the samples. I think it's very appropriate for this type of work. Mainly we devote, the instrument has been almost 80% of the time devoted to this water reuse because we have several projects on this in this area. It's easy to optimize, it's very useful to get this. You can analyze large batch of samples, identification, detection. We have this library, a spectral library, which I think is very important. If this can be increased, of course, I'm sure there is much more chemicals now in the library, probably. The QTOF MSMS is also an efficient instrument. Now There is a new one in the market, so it will be even better. So many metabolites were identified. You can identify. They were identified. I think this is very important in order to know what is the, in this case of ibuprofen, because it was the chemical that we did study much more. There was also quite a good for accuracy, fragmentation, identification of metabolites. The different wild plants. They was identified in this chemical, some of them for the first time, because some of these plants were never identified the exposure to these chemicals. This was done for the first time. And the last part goes to the accumulation in crops. We know that, well, in Saudi Arabia and other parts of the world, I mean, in Israel is where they also did much more of this work. Now we are also in Spain, we are also doing part of this work. Some countries, California, so Australia, only the countries at this moment, only the areas where there is the scarcity problem and they have a tradition to have wastewater treatment and reuse, they know that this is a problem. Probably this will be expanded in the future to other parts of the world. So quite a lot of important information you can establish about the distribution of these chemicals between the plant, the soil, the sediment. You know, this is very important to know it. It's also very important to be careful about this and to have this range of chemical contaminants that can pose a risk to human health. The risk to human health will depend very much on the type of the crop, the type of chemical. At this moment, the only document that I read that shows a certain risk to kids is carrots irrigated with wastewater. And this has been reported not by us, by Israel, by Chefitz in Israel, who did a lot of work on this area. He said that the level of carbamazepine or lamotrigine in carrots, if kids are eating carrots irrigated with this, can be a risk for the kids, for little kids, not for, let's say, old people or older people. So, but I think the more information is coming. What happens with the lettuce? Because lettuce is picking up a lot of these chemicals, and everybody is eating lettuce. And so, but I think this is one aspect, and the other one, as I mentioned to you before, is the wildlife and the biodiversity. Because we don't want to lose biodiversity by doing this. So I think we should work under safe conditions. And thank you very much for your attention. If there is any question, I can take it. Thank you very much.